Hi everyone, I'm Chen. As you probably already noticed, I'm originally from Taiwan, the little tropical island, and happen to orchids is our biggest ornamental plants. And then even now, almost every orchid you find now in Walmart, Safeway, Whole Foods, very likely either they are tissue cultured from Taiwan and sell to here, or they just shipping the adult plant, not a flower yet, in the shipping container with lower temperature, so they are kind of trigger the flower and then brought them to United States and then waiting for a few months flower and sell. So that's why almost every people in Taiwan, we kind of see orchid all the time, and then you are surprised how many people in Taiwan can do tissue culture for fun. I will say a little bit my childhood experiences about my tissue culture later, but you will be like, these people, they are crazy. They do tissue culture in the kitchen. Yeah. And I want to introduce myself. I'm currently an assistant professor in NC State. I do ornamental plant breeding. And tissue culture is not our research topic. It's actually our research tool. A lot of our research is actually based on tissue culture. Sorry, my mother language is Mandarin, and we don't have tense in verbs. So you go there, you go there yesterday, you go there tomorrow, you don't change the verbs. Okay, so this is my experiences. Since I was very, very young, I became a little bit crazy gobbyfish breeder. Because you know how much yard you can have as kids, but you can definitely put a 10 aquarium tank in the house. So I started my breeding career since I was very young, and I was become kind of famous when I was a college kid. I started sell fish. I did sell fish. Yeah, it was my part-time career at that time. And then after I go to master's degree, I started working on chromosome and polyploidity, that kind of research. It made me a little bit more engaged in scientific research and then breeding. So it's like, I have some breeding experience, I think it's fun, and then I jump to the other place and I start to do chromosome and research. And then I, of course, then tissue culture in a different level because that's research purpose, tissue culture. And then I get my PhD in the United States. I went to Oregon State, and the reason I'm here, probably the reason that my former advisor, Ryan Contreras, he is actually native North Carolina. And then, so he was making joking like, NC sent him out and then he sent me back. So now we are equal. And then I did a lot of hibiscus, lilacs, and then hemp. Actually, after I graduated from OSU, there's what's time, you know, the farm bill just passed. So everywhere in the United States, there's a lot of hemp companies that opening. So I was hired as a breeder in one of the company, and we will talk this a little bit later why this is related to tissue culture. But you will surprise how much slides that are related to hemp. Because I don't want to just steal photos on the internet, but you know, a lot of my photo was from my career. And then, okay, so this is outlined today, and not a surprise, you can tell what the plan is. We are talking about plant propagation because I believe every one of you somehow has good level of skill. We just mentioned about grafting. I still have no success in grafting any conifers. It's like mysterious for me. And then we will go through from plant propagation to tissue culture to what can we do if you don't have a fancy lab in the home. You can actually do something or use tissue culture as your hobby or enhance your hobby activities. So we are talking about start from plant propagation. So I don't want to go to Horticulture 101 and give you a final exam, but long to short, plant propagation, yeah, there's no final, don't worry. Plant propagation has two categories. One is sexually propagation, one is asexual propagation. Sex propagation, 99% chance, not always. We refer to anything you start from seed. And then think about seeds. I don't know if you look different from your siblings. My brother looks like alien to me. So we never identify as a family member because if we walk in together, you will thought it's just a random two Asians walking there. So yeah, that's how the problem of seed. Seed is easy, you can put in soil, you can get a plant, you can store it forever. But the problem is there are some certain level of ununiform, unless it's a very intense breeding in the back. And then the more thing we do is asexual propagation, which we make clone, we make cutting, we make air layer. Anything you learned, you tried in your yard, mostly likely I'm asexual propagated. And then there's a lot of pros and cons. As we mentioned, if you start from seeds, the pros is, you know, they are, the problem is they are less uniform. Like my brother and me, we are from different seeds. So we look brandly different, although we have the same parents. And then if you get any seed from your apple, please don't start that. Because we breeders are crazy. If you get a seed from a 90% good apple, I'm 99% guarantee the seedling 10 years later, you get a very terrible apple. Well, we designed that, okay. So yes, that's our terrible thing. But anyway, don't try to start seed unless you know there's some breeder already working on the seed already. Or likely you get a very terrible plant 10 years, 5 years later. It's not worth it to try. But there's always some benefit from seed. You can, first, they are easy to storage. You can storage apple seed for 10 years, 5 years maybe, but you are not able to storage a small apple plant for 5 years in your closet. So pros and cons, right? But goes to asexual propagation. First benefit, that's why almost every ornamental are propagated by this way, because they are genetically identical. Pretty much means you cut my finger and get the other direction there. So you guarantee it's not better, not worse. It's 100% the same genetically. And then the other thing is uniform. You can make cutting at the same time, so you can get 10 plants with the same genome background, with the same environment, so every plant will be very similar. So you won't get my brother. But the problem is, it's very time sensitive. Like you are propagating a conifer, it probably can get plant material year round. But if you are working on surface, you're working on surface grafting, you need to use a specific method in specific season. There's only two seasons are available. And then each season, there's a preferred method. So it's a very time sensitive thing if you want to do propagation for many ornamental plants. And the other thing is very seasonal and time sensitive is the same thing. I don't know why I put it together. And then the other thing is once your mother plant has disease, you can, you know, it's easy to clean your seed, put in bleach for 30 seconds, the next generation will be clean, unless it's virus, right? But if you start from grafting, cutting, or air layer, whatever the mother plant has the disease, they will pass down, likely, unless you are very careful. But how many chances we are really able to identify any disease and then working on every treatment? In many cases, we just kill them. So asexual propagation has this issue. And then think about if you are in a company, you need to propagate 1 million plants per year. It's a big challenge. So that's why sometimes when we do propagation, it always needs some professional people like Tim. He knows there's a disease, whatever we need to treat them, and we can do next generation. So it can be very hard. The other thing is it takes a lot of spaces. Think about one seed and one clone. And if you want to make 100 seedlings, two trays can work. But 100 grafting, next week, if you start working on grafting in JCIA, you will see how much space each one, and then they don't guarantee 100% success, and it's very skill depends. So you know, both of them has pros and cons. But we crazy scientists, we always find a circumvent. Of course, that's our job. So, so let's focus on the problem of asexual propagation, because if we really want to propagate 1 million hibiscus, but we don't want to go through all the problems, what can we do? Actually, that's how tissue culture jumped into our economic or research work. So think about this. This is a phytex, and then every end of season, how many seed you ever know phytex? It's one of my new favorites. I didn't know this plant until recently, because I started to do research. So how many seeds you see? You see them, and they are still on the plant. They are still now on the plant. It's 1 million. So if you want to propagate 1 million vitex from seeds, it seems to be rational, right? Because you can get a lot of seed easily. But even this big plant, you probably can get 20 clones, or you will sacrifice the whole plant. So first thing, if we are always propagated by clone, it takes a lot of plant material, which means it's slow. You need to wait your plants to big enough to make a certain good number, if lucky, of clone. So it's a very slow process to do propagation. And also, again, it's seasonal. Second, pathogen. This is a sweet potato that Greg Yencho, our sweet potato breeder, he brought this huge, like infant sweet potato back to our building. And of course, it looks cute, but if you dig more, each sweet potato, if you didn't give them a good sanitizer, how much fungus can be stored inside? How much nematodes? How much bacteria? Will be, you bring one sweet potato home, if they are not from grocery store that will already spread crazy things. They can bring anything. They can bring all the disease, go to your yard. So propagation is always challenging. So now, solution is actually tissue culture. Why? First, think about this. If you never do tissue culture or you have no idea what it is, put this picture in your brain and we will go deeper. I'm kind of imprinting you. This is tissue culture and a small jar. You can see my hand. This is real my hand. So how small the jar? You can see the size of jar and how small the plant piece we have. We will start from there. First, what we also call tissue culture micropropagation. So we need to start from the word. You are better in English than me. So what's micro mean? Small, right? So we talk about when we do asexual propagation, we need more tissue. But micropropagation, the original means we only need a small piece of tissue. So think about your neighbor who has the wheat. And then you want to make clone, likely you need this stem cutting like this big, right? That's how you need. But look at the tissue culture, what we start with. It's like less than 1 inch plant tissue we need to start a plant propagation. So it's not a high space consuming anymore, right? And also we talk about the speed. We mentioned the vitex. It takes a lot of plant material, so you need to wait the model plant to big enough to do next clone propagation. But now each stem, you can start like 10, 20 small plantlets. So the speed is obviously improved, right? So the two problem has been somehow solved. And the other thing is, how many of you have orchid at home? Yeah, you know, thank you. I appreciate from Taiwan. Okay, so if you have this orchid, it's not, you know, it's not expensive at all. But if you try to propagate it, you probably spend 3 years. If you're lucky enough, you get one small plantlet from the flower stalk. And don't you feel like the price doesn't make sense? If you spend 3 years propagate one plant and they sell you $10, okay. Right? So you know something wrong. This is not what we do commercially. So the other example I want to say talk about orchids that speed up the propagation process is tissue culture. And you can see this jar. In commercial world or in Taiwan, I want to share one small experience. The first person teach me tissue culture is not my high school teacher. I went to a noodle store in the street and they sell this. And I start to go there every day to talk to the owner. Finally, he feel I'm a trustable person. So we start talking about orchids and turns out he has a orchid greenhouse in the roof, on the roof. And then he also have a small tissue culture facility in his kitchen. And few months later, I was invited to go to his house and he started teaching me tissue culture. I don't recommend to go to anyone's house nowadays. It's a little bit dangerous now, but in the past, it seems to be rational, right? So I went to his house, he teach me how to do tissue culture. That's how I start. So it's not a magic, but it's just how much you want and how much you need. If you are crazy orchid collector, you probably will go there one day, believe me. So this is how tissue culture goes from. And then what is tissue culture? You can see the gel, I put this, right? This is the gel. And what's the gel? We actually provide everything plants need. Whatever your fertilizer is, whatever your soil you provide to the plants, we actually put everything in the little gel-like thing. And do you know photosynthesis? There's a fancy thing. What's a product of photosynthesis? Sucrose, right? The sweetness. And then we steal them sweetness to get on our table. But anyway, we also provide them back. And then, so that's everything we put and put the agar, which is also the kitchen ingredient. So turns out we just give them fertilizer, sugar, agar, and whatever they think of, sometimes potato, sometimes banana, put it in a blender. So from now, everything seems like, yeah, we can do that at home, right? And then since we provide every nutrition they like, so when you make clone, you need a lot much plant tissue and then they help each other. Hopefully they can recover themselves, eventually give you a root. But if you give them that much like super care, they actually can start from any small little piece of tissue. So that's why you speed up. And then in a few weeks, this is one plant, orchid plant. And then this is a small bulb we call LB. PLB, protocol-like body. This is, you can think of them as a small embryo. And in tissue culture environment, if you bring them out, they will die immediately. But if you stay them in tissue culture medium, you can cut into half. In 2 weeks, they become 10. Cut into half, each one. In 2 weeks, they become another 10. So you can see how fast we can propagate the plant. And then we put them into the different medium that have then different hints, like, okay, stop propagate, you are now growing. So they become 100 million plants you want. So you just keep propagating the small bulb thing and until you won't stop and make them to other medium, they can become a new orchid. That's how what we do in the commercial world. And that's very quick. But the critical is, what are you going to support them? You know, orchids tricky. If you give them wrong nutrition, they just don't go to the way you want, right? And in tissue culture, it's even more critical. Sometimes even different cultivar, we need to adjust what they like. So a little bit more sugars, a little bit more amino acids, sometimes eat a little bit more banana. Yeah, banana is a commercial recipe. And then some company, they are very crazy, like I need banana from this farm specifically, because different farm actually have different banana with different nutritions. But that's what we are now in the United States, we try to avoid that kind of recipe because we want every recipe become very consistency. So we call compote, I don't remember. Not a confirmed ingredient, because banana is not a confirmed. Every banana is different. We want everything from the powder chemistry companies. So look, we talk about space. This is a million, and it's not bigger than this table. So that's how you speed up and you use very, very narrow spaces to propagate them. That's the magic of tissue culture. And the other thing we also talk about, so we now solve the problem of slow and space. And now we are talking about time sensitive. The other image I want you to print, this is how we work in lab. And then when you do propagation, of course, you need to do a lot seasonal, as I mentioned. Sources you can only graft in 2 seasons, and each season has specific methods. If you use the wrong method, it just doesn't work. But from tissue culture, if you initiate in the right time, and then everything is indoor, and you don't give them a little chance to see the real sun, and some of the species, we even give them 24-hour light to speed them up. And some species, we just don't need to give them light. So they don't care, because everything they need are supported. Even sugars, so many of them, they don't even do photosynthesis anymore. So time sensitive is not an issue anymore. But how do we do that? Think about, we mentioned the gel. I say there's a lot of nutrition, there's amino acids, there's a lot of sugars. If you put your edible gel on the table for more than 1 week, what happened? It get mold, it get a bacteria, you get an old collection of pathogen in your house. It's actually how we test. If I bring a medium to your house, open 10 seconds and close, and next week I will report what fungus you have in your house. So that's how we really do. But let's go back here. In tissue culture, since we overprotect them, we provide everything that plants need. So it's very nutritious. And then acceptable or make the environment sterile will be very challenging. First, this is not exactly size, but it's the right ratio. This is the size of plant cell. This is the size ratio of bacteria. And bacteria has super small cell. They can absorb a little bit tiny nutrients and double themselves in every 20 minutes. And plants, if lucky enough, maybe half day. So if you put both of them in the medium that provide every crazy nutritious, including smashed banana, you can think how fast bacterial fungus can grow and how slow the plant can be comparatively. So first important thing for your tissue culture is how are you going to make your small environment, everything outside, you don't care, in the small jar, how are you going to make them sterile? And also when you introduce the original plants in, how are you going to make them sterile? That's always a big challenge for us. Now there are some small company that even put some antibiotic and antifungus into the gel. So you can do easy tissue culture anywhere if they are not super dirty. But there's no standard of super dirty. You can try if your house is clean enough. So now we know season is not a problem. Space is not a problem. Speed is not a problem. Seems like it's, tissue culture is perfect, right? So now we are going to go through deeper. What is tissue culture? So there's a lot of function we do tissue culture. And now you know tissue culture is we take a small piece of plant material into a jar with no bacteria inside, right? And then we provide everything they need. They can start growing and you can multiply them in the jar many, many generations until you decide to bring them out. That's how we learn from tissue culture now. But the thing is, tissue culture actually uses a lot more than just propagation. And one thing I want you to think, everyone knows horse and donkey. If you hybrid them, they will become horse and donkey, become emu, right? So what's the problem of emu? Sterile. So when you are a plant breeder like me, sometimes you want them sterile, but in many, many other chains, you want them to go next generation so you can introduce gene between two different species. And on the other hand, this is a lucky case. It's the horse and donkey, but in other animals, there's just no result. In plant as well, you probably can ask Tim, sometimes we have two plants in different species that look similar. We just really want them hybrid and combine some gene or introduce cohardiness of one osmanthus to the other fragrant osmanthus. But they just never able to set a seed. And as a scientific person, we found that sometimes if you hybrid, they give you a fruit, but the fruit will be not able to be mature and they will abort it because some genetic background that they are not matched happening. So what can we do? Think about that. We mentioned this small little jar is actually super care environment, right? So what can we do is we actually, we call, well, I skipped one slide. We call embryo rescue. When you, after you hybrid two plants, and then after you try it a million times, the seeds will always never be able to mature before they drop. We can actually extract the embryo into the medium, and the seed is easier because everything inside the food are sterile. So you just put the bleach on all the food and then peel them out in the safe, clean environment, and you can bring them to the medium. So the non-developed embryo, we can actually extract them from the food and put it in the medium and give them all the nutrients they want. So the original mother plant cannot handle them, but we can actually make them artificially work. So this is one of the case. This is lycoris. They are two native species in Taiwan. I was working on their chromosome. But funny story, I never see them flowering in our greenhouse because every week we bring them out from soil and cut them the root and do research on them. So for my 3 years in the academic clinic, is one of our research institutions, I never see a flower. So the first time I see a lot of flower was actually in this campus. Because we finally don't put them out and treat them the root every 2 weeks. So yeah, like always, and there's a funny story. Many chains we hybrid two things. We want to either make the media F1 or introduce genes, but there's a lot of surprise can happen like this. If you know that there's a yellow flower and there's a red flower which We have a lot in this campus. When you hybrid it, it's not orange, it's white. And we actually even give them a new hybrid name. Stichora is albino, right, Tim?
Not sure. There's no
Lycoris. Lycoris cross. Albino something with ant, I'm not sure, but it means white. But this is an interspecific hybrid. And as a plant breeder, we do this all the time. And in many chances, we just never have chance to get a seed. That's why we need tissue culture. And there's no way we can avoid it. And the other thing, if you are orchid breeder, there's a software you can track in the plant in your home, how many parents or their pedigree is. An orchid breeder is a little bit crazy like me. If you track him back, each cultivar, they can contain more than 6 species. Because we already use tissue culture to solve every problem. So breeders like us, like free to hybrid. So we just, okay, there's a new species in front of the mountain, let's try. Boom. Oh, good, fragrant. And the other species we found from Philippines, somewhere neighbor reported, bring them home and tissue culture a little bit, and once they flower, hybrid to the your cultivars. Oh, yellow flower comes. And then more and more gene they found from different species, because we can do tissue culture, embryo rescue, we kind of free from making them hybrid, they introduce gene and fluent in all the population. So every orchid breeder, we actually have this, a lot of chance you make hybrid at home, they sometimes aborted, most likely aborted, some of them will produce some more seeds. But if you want to do propagation on the seeds, you really need tissue culture. And the other thing is, even it's a pure species of orchids, you still need to do tissue culture, because orchids is a weird plant. Their seed is like, have you, anyone here see orchid seed? Not Jerry, I know you know. He was in our plant propagation class, yeah. So orchid seed, if you hybrid your orchids at home, that you will see seed in 1 week, fruit in 1 week, and then it takes around 200 days, depends on species, and they will mature. And then if lucky, they are still fertile, the fruit will open in 200 days to sometimes 400 days, and you will see a lot of dust dropping. And you were like, what's that? They are actually seed. And orchid seed is how they survive. So their seed is so dusty and light, they only have like 100-ish cells. So, and the wind spray them, so the little seed will spray to other trees. So that's why they can stay on the tree, by the way. So the seed will go to other trees, but the seed has no nutrition to support themselves, because there's only 100 cells. So they need another fungus that coexists. What's the word to say? Symbiotic. They need a symbiotic fungus to support in sucrose, and the orchid later will support in like a dorm or a space for them to live. So since orchids will become bigger, they can provide the nutrition wet later, so they have benefit to each other. That's how orchid seeds survived. And then if you put the dust in your yard or any material medium you use, unlikely you can get any orchid babies. Only one species that can actually do that easily. But otherwise, that's unlikely you can get that. So that's why each orchid fruit, they have a few million seeds. So naturally, few of them will survive. And you don't want to gamble in this number at your home. It's impossible. So what we do, we actually, again, bring the orchid seeds, like mostly like a dust, in and sterile them and put it in the medium. And almost every seed, depends on what plants you work. Sometimes 20%, sometimes 90%. But remember, they are a million seeds. So 20% of a million. Someone can count for me. I generally pretty good at math, but not before 11 a.m. So that's how we do breeding, and we can get a huge population. And then this process only takes like 3 months. But naturally, they take a few years. Finally, they can find their fungus, and fungus will blah, blah, blah. I don't even know how they survive in a while. And then a few years later, you get a small orchid plant. But now, 3 months, you see a small orchid. And then even in our class, we have student comes. Everyone is first time tissue culture. They can get 100 million orchid baby easily. So, and once away, we just give away because it's too much. We never try to keep them. And the other thing we do is chromosome doubling. And I don't know if you're aware, chromosome doubling is a very, very important skill we do plant breeding. And then, King, can you provide any example?
I'm not good at that.
Okay.
You mean like plants?
Yeah, any plants that are popular are most likely to polyploid. That people here were more familiar with.
Hosta that are polyploid.
What?
There's a lot of hosta that are polyploid.
Yes.
Strawberry.
Stay lilies. It's not only polyploid. It's crazy that we do everything on it. But yeah, daily lead, we have a lot of polyploidity. And then strawberry, if you go to the mountain, you see a small original one. But nowadays in the supermarket, the size is at least this, right? If you bring this strawberry home, your family was like, that's so small. Now it's like, we want this, right? So strawberry is actually tetraploid. And most native or human beings, we call ourselves diploid, which means if you remember your high school genetics, there's something big A, small a, right? So you have two, big and small, or big, or small. We assume that everyone has two. But plants, they are more open-minded. We can make them four and six, or three. And then polyploidy manipulation can be a magic, because when we introduce chemical or whatever method to make them from two chromosome set to four, we call tetraploid. And what happened tetraploid? Likely they get a bigger fruit, strawberry. They get a bigger flower, hibiscus. They get a compact and shorter plant, hibiscus. Sorry, I know this plant more. And then, the other thing is when you eat banana, have you ever observed any seeds? It's a watermelon, seedless watermelon. It's a triploid. So when you make a diploid to tetra and hybrid tetra, which means four, to two, and averagely you get a three. That's how you get a triploid. And that's how seedless watermelon comes from. That's how banana comes from. So you will never need to get a seed from banana. And why is watermelon occasionally give you one or two seeds? Because the triploid get a lot of imbalance. So there's only 0.1% chance that you get a real seed. But you know, originally there's a lot of seeds. So one or two of them still survive. But that one will be never healthy because they still struggle about chromosome balancing thing. But let's don't go there. So when we do tissue culture or we do plant breeding, polyploidy manipulation, we actually do a lot of in tissue culture. Because like now, if I want to treat a Xerxes plant, I need 100 plants. 100 plants means the size of this room, right? Xerxes tree. But if I treat 100 plants in tissue culture, which means two jars. So, and then plants are all from a small space. So if we convert one cell to a plant, it's easier. But if I start from this plant, I convert this side of tissue to tetraploid. The other side is still diploid. So that's why a lot of chances we use tissue culture to do polyploidy manipulation. It's one of the process that we want our plants either bigger flower, seedless, or other specific targets we want. And this is polyploidy manipulation that's from a paper. It's a crepe myrtle. So think about 120 plants of crepe myrtle if we want to do research, but now that's how we have in tissue culture. A lot easier, right? So you can repeat your experience 100 times by three jars instead of a whole yard. And then I want to mention this is original chromosome. I know it's a dot, just long to short, we double them. So if they have 20 chromosomes, they become 40. 20, yeah. So that's polyploidy manipulation. And we also observe their cell size will be also enlarged. And because every cell is enlarged, the flower is enlarged, the leaf is enlarged. But the funny thing is, after everything enlarged, the plant looks more compact. And then tetraploid plants tend to be shorter because they kind of become too fat. So they don't grow up, they grow white. And polymental, that's what we want, right? You want a slim hibiscus or a very compact, right? So that's why polyploidity is kind of we emphasize a lot in my lab. And yeah, that's one of my proud production. So we also find that we did triploid hemp. And if you don't know, hemp have genders. And then only female plant has the production of either medical or recreational. And then turns out we make a lot of triploid. And If you can see the picture, this is original diploid. The seed, the flower, oh, sorry, the leaf is kind of small, and so you can see a complicated form. But when we make it in triploid, the plant is enlarged. So you can see every branch is enlarged, every leaf is enlarged, and see the flower. This is diploid flower, it's a little bit soggy, it's, you know, open form. And then triploid flower is a lot of like compact and fat. So tensile is preferred in the market. So, and then think about cut flower rows. If you make it in tetraploid, they actually have bigger flower and slightly shorter plant form. So preferred, right? So most nowadays, most commercial rows are likely triploid and tetra because diploid is not a competitive anymore. And the other thing is very, very scientific. You won't want to do that. I never success. We talk about big A, small a, you have two sets, right? But when plants, when they produce pollen, you can drop the two set to one set. And then we can actually, if you're crazy enough in tissue culture, you bring the pollen out, but in tissue culture, it can culture the one set cell, become a new plant. So the plant doesn't have big A, small a anymore. It only have one small a. So sometimes when you need to combine the recessive gene, if you have one, a quarter after F2, right? But if you have two, that's 1/16. If you have three genes, that's... So, but if you start from haploid, you only have one. So it's easy to have a small a. Because once you get one small a, it's small a. There's no debating anymore, right? So sometimes when we want to combine a lot of recessive gene, we actually use this way. We directly extract the pollen and put it in the tissue culture environment, and then we get a plant which is we call haploid. And then we can double haploid to diploid because they are doubled by artificial environment. So every gene will be homozygous. So you won't have big A, small a. You only have big A, or small a, small a. And this is, I know it's probably not our case, but this is very important in our research. And then you were surprised, every rice, wheat, or cereal you eat, they actually, we need to do 6 or 7 generations to create homozygous. But by this way, you can do homozygous in one generation. So, and then barley is the almost our, we call it model plant now. Because barley, haploid barley is so easy to make. So almost every barley cultivar you find, they don't self in 7 generation anymore. They just use this way. So to get a homozygous barley. So that's, yeah, something you thought is not, you never think, but every barley production you eat actually have some tissue culture technique on the back. Background. So this is how it looks like at the very beginning. Once you get an embryo pollen in the right stage, put it in a buffer with all nutrients, they can eventually become a smallet. This is going to be root. This is going to be the shoot. Yeah, and this is like something between your nails size. And then the other thing, mutation. So in JCIA, I believe, Tim, you once a while find a mutation from one branch. And what we do, we cut it, propagate them, right? But we scientists, we need a promotion. So we need to do a lot more intense. We cannot just wait in mutation happen. There's a lot of things we can do. We put chemicals, we put then in gamma ray. We actually have a nuclear center in the campus. They do nuclear research, but they have byproducts that we can like tell them, like, can we give you this plant material and you help me to put it in your chamber and make them shot by the something crazy nuclear, and then we can get a lot of mutation. And think about that. If I am a camellia breeder, I'm not allowed to bring the whole plant into the chamber. The chamber is like this big. So what can I do? I actually need to make them in tissue culture with high density inside a plate. So in a small limited number space of chamber, I can put as much plant as possible. And each time it's 3-day treatment, it's $200. If I don't have tissue culture skill, I can put like 10 branch and they don't necessarily success. But now we have tissue culture, I can put a few hundred plants and into mutation. And then a lot of flowers actually was produced by this way, breed by this way, like poinsettia. A lot of poinsettia cultivar, they are using gamma ray. And they do tissue culture and then put it in gamma ray and bring them out and see which one mutated. So is mom plant, Crescentium. Crescentium has naturally good mutation in the ground, but if you want to do intense mutation, you do tissue culture and make 100 million plants and put it in the chamber, and you or put the chemicals in, and you can get a lot of different color. And this is one paper, they do mutation from one plant, and after all, they can get that much different colors in the tissue culture in just few jars. So now we are also want to say, you probably hear biotechnology in this campus a lot. People emphasize that we don't call tissue culture or biotechnology anymore, but a lot of biotechnology will be still rely on tissue culture. If without tissue culture, you just don't have the chance to do it. Some species you can skip it, but 90% chance not. Why tissue culture is important? So biotechnology, I don't want to give another semester class in this, but long to sure, there's one plant cell, you make them change in DNA level. You sometimes insert DNA, insert some gene. One of the cases is they insert blue pigment gene to one of the rows. So they turn the white rows to blue. That cultivar has already released in Japan. So, but think about how are you going to insert a gene to a cell? And a plant has a million cell. So even you get one cell inserted, the other cell is still original version. What can you do? Now you need a tissue culture. So by some manipulation, we can actually have a new group of plant cell or plant, new plants, originally from one single cell. Where is it? One single cell. So this is original cell. We shut them and bring them new genes, like the purple pigment gene, into this cell, and then we can trigger the cell, become an embryo, eventually become a new plant. Every single cell carry the gene we bring it in. So that's why you get a blue rose instead of only a few spots in the petal. So yeah, again, transgenic or a lot of plant biotechnology, we modify the gene, we change the gene, but they all need to form single cell. And if that's the case, you need to form tissue culture. And this is how we do transgenic. Basically, we put a little piece, this is case of tobacco. You just put a little piece of the leaf, and the way we use is actually the, what's the tool we punch papers? Hole punch. We use the paper hole punch on the leaf and put the segment and then sterile a small segment and then put them there and use biotechnology to shut, deliver or whatever, bring the new gene or change the gene of a few cells, and eventually we do selection on those cells, and then some plants will grow in from the new type of cell, and then you can get the new type of plant which is transgenic or modified. And then this is a very, very new technology we call CRISPR. So in the past, what we can do is we deliver genes to add function. That's what we can do. So if you want to add me, you need to find a blue gene to make me blue. But the chance is a lot of times in plant breeding, we just want to simply modify something without bringing new things. So there's a new technology we call CRISPR. So to a very human language, CRISPR is a technology. In the past, I mentioned I use gamma ray, right? I randomly have a mutant, and they can show in any gene. But now we finally have the technology. I target it on one gene and make the gene mutant directly or randomly. So long to short, we don't really bring the gene. We just use some technology. Targeting on one gene, we know their function and modify it. And this is out of topic. In human research now, there's some people, they have a blood genetic disease. What they do is they extraction their melon, right? Melon cells, and modify a little bit because their gene carries some disease. They modify the gene and bring them back. They didn't put new genes. So those people can be now treated. In the past, there's no way to treat it. So that's CRISPR used in human medication world. But in plants, we don't have that much ethical issue anymore. So you can see this is a flower original. This is a very dark purple flower. And then they targeting on anthocyanin, which is the pigment gene. And then they kind of mutant them in certain different way. So when we mutate the entomophilin gene, we can change the way the expression, the how much the expression, or where the expression. So from these plants, we can actually modify them to all different kind of color or pattern. So that's how CRISPR can do. And this technology seems fancy, but they still, again, rely on tissue culture. So tissue culture will be more than functional than propagation in nowadays world. In this campus, we don't do propagation that much. We actually do plant biotechnology or breeding more by tissue culture. And then the last thing I want to mention, tissue culture, so far I probably talk tissue culture like a magic. But again, remember where I learned, it's a kitchen. So I want to mention, what can you do? When are you going to use tissue culture and what can you do? And in, actually you need to read some paper, find some resource, but it's totally doable if you really want. Oh, just come to my lab. Okay. First thing, if you find a new mutation, you want to propagate them, you probably want to tissue culture because or you were waiting 5 years until the mutation branch go big enough and then you can propagate. Or the other thing is sometimes new mutated branch, they are much weaker. So non-mutated one will eventually taking over. So if you don't propagate them on time, it will lost the new mutation you have. So this is the time you need to do intense propagation. If you want large scale and sell to someone, you need to do tissue culture. Or share to a lot of your friends, look how many people here. If you can get this new branch, if you don't do tissue culture, you probably need 5 years to propagation, right? And second thing, if you have orchids or plants that you really need to propagate and the plant is not naturally able to propagate easily, you will need to consider tissue culture. And orchid is probably the most extreme case because you just don't have a chance to propagate them without tissue culture. Oh, well, you can wait 3 years. And the other thing is, in many chances you want to do your hybrid orchids. So anyone here other than, I know you know, other than him know how to do pollination of orchids? Okay, I didn't prepare this, but next time when you have an orchid at home, you see the flower in the center, there's a crystal-like thing. And then you can actually find a small cap. If you open a small cap, you will see two granules of anthers. They are a million pollens. And on the crystal-like thing, there's a little bit space below it. And you can see sticky and jelly. And if you put the pollen into the jelly space, and you finish the pollination. And then one thing, interesting phenomenon is, next day you can see the space closed. Because they are kind of like, I'm loyalty. I just don't want time. So they close. And then in 2 days, the petal will be dropping. Not dropping, will be dried. And then you can see the base of fruit will start to elongate it. So in just a few weeks, the base part will become the fruit like this size. So it's pretty fun to observing. And then not even you want to do tissue culture, but just fun. I do that all the time. So when I was in Taiwan, if you see a restaurant with an orchid plant is fruiting, probably I visited a few weeks ago. Oh, and now in Raleigh, if you see that, probably still me. I was just talking to the owner and then do my pollination. So this is one of the things, this is one of cultivar I really don't like. But again, this is a crazy breeder thing. We breeder have one issue. We want to create something special or combination or trait. But for me, when they combine the purple, dark purple spots with yellow, it really like over rotten banana. I call it just rot banana. This is ugly. Okay, so go back to tissue culture. Since you have motivation, first thing, go to eBay. Just Google tissue culture kit home. You can actually get the gel already made. Or the gel for orchids, you just need to make it like you can get a powder. You just put water and cook it. It's the new medium. And of course, you need instant pot because you need to sterile the jar. And if you buy the kit, you actually get a lot of instruction. And believe me, it's not difficult. And second thing, you need to find a small space that's comparatively clean. And this is a case I get it from online. So they put just a whatever basket and then put a little hole. So you put your hands in and do whatever you can. And because of the limited airflow, so you don't bring that much bacteria. Of course, you spray alcohol before you do anything. So that's one thing we do. And when I was younger than the kitchen person teaching me how to do the tissue culture, what I do is, you know, I was a garbage fish breeder. So what I have, fish tanks. So I put a plastic membrane in the fish tank and then put the two holes and put my hands in and start doing my tissue culture. Yeah, I was a nerd kid. I don't spoil that much. Yeah, so you can actually do that. And nowadays, things are much, much friendly. Because in the past, what ingredient I know is fish tank and then instant pot, which we call autoclave now. And then food jars. Who doesn't have food jars? And then for the medium, best idea it will be water-soluble fertilizers. And then sugars. So you basically give them soil and photosynthesis. So what else plant needs, right? And then agar, which you don't want them flowing in the liquid. So that's you put agar, and then they are actually just random agar. And the sugar I use even now in the lab, the sugars I use is actually table sugar. Yeah, because the lab sugar is like 100 times more expensive. And the plant just doesn't care to get a little bit more amino acids. So we use table sugar all the time, even in the fancy lab. And then, of course, you can try your mature orchid. That's a very easy start. Or whatever seed from fruit or something inside a carrot. Because inside the tissue is sterile. So you just peel them and then they are sterile inside. So yeah, try start from easier thing. And there's a lot of instruction online. And I think you will enjoy that, try a little bit. The easiest thing, probably onion, because everything inside are sterile. You just bring them in, peel, don't cry, and then put it in the medium. You can eventually get, because they are somehow sealed, so you probably don't cry as that you do in kitchen. And the other thing I want to say is, if you just want to do your hybrid, find a mutation, do propagation, there are some small company locally everywhere, they just never advertisement. Like this is one of our graduate students. She is a graduate student, also have a small company. I just realized recently. And I am a crazy African violet collector, and some cultivars I need a specific way to do propagation instead of leaf. So I actually just, can you do this for me? I can pay you $50. So easier way, there's a tons of small company. They can be just students part-time job and you can just hire them to do and they have all the knowledge. So you don't necessarily do it yourself unless you are as crazy as like me. A 12-year-old kid put the aquarium tank, burn his hair a few times. I still have no hair on my hands. I don't know if it's genetics or I doing tissue culture too much. Because first step of tissue culture, spray alcohol as much as possible. Second, light your alcohol lamp. And now we have device that there's a like channel, you just put the tools in so you don't need a real light anymore. So I don't allow my student use light anymore because I still don't have hair. So yeah, this is a lot of things and this is what I want to say. Tissue culture has a lot of fun. And at home, you can propagate it do next breeding for your personal plants. And then in a commercial world, a lot of plants are actually propagated by tissue culture. Like every hazelnut tree, every blueberry tree, if they are commercial produced, they are from tissue culture. And for breeders or scientific person, we use tissue culture as our tools to do our whatever manipulation on the plants all the time. And it works very well. And at the end, I really encourage you to try to play a little bit or think about what tissue culture can do for you to elaborate your habit or your plants in your yard. And then if you try a few times, doesn't work, maybe some small company like that, one person company, one of our graduate students can help. And then I know more than one that's everywhere because that's not a fancy skill anymore. It's just every graduate student can do that. All right, thank you. This is the presentation.